All right. Well then, welcome Austin to my domain, the beautiful, bustling technocratic city of Kyodi. As you were not present for other session zeros, I will describe this city to you. This is a massive city, not just in sheer circumference, but what's the word I'm looking for?
Vertically.
Yeah, vertically, but in sheer capacity of everything here. Like Van mentioned, this city is also extremely tall. It thins out as you get to the Mangrove District, which is the outer ring of the city. But these sections of the city are not just the ground level. There is multiple levels above, and there are levels below. Ethan's dying. Okay. I'm actually gonna move you to the world map.
Ooh.
I don't know if you have seen it, but
I am glad that you have everything listed as, like, if I'm staring at a map, it's great.
To put the size into perspective, that circle here, that is the size of one hex in Explorers.
Oh.
This is an extremely large city.
I was going to say, because one hex is 12 miles?
Yes.
Jesus fucking Christ. You could literally spend days going across the Aetherian Academy.
Not across the Aetherian Academy. It's not that big. That's just a marker indicating where it is. It's not that entire section. Zone. It's not this entire section here.
I get you, but
yeah, originally
these sections are sections of like main roads.
Yeah, I was originally gonna have individual buildings, and I gave up on that real quick. So, yeah. It's chunks, and you just need to imagine that the main there's main streets, and then there's side streets, and then there's back streets, and then there's alleyways that all branch off from those main streets.
Either way, like, I'm gonna have to live at the fucking academy as it is, because getting anywhere was like a fucking week travel to get from like one zone to another.
Not necessarily.
Not necessarily. You would not have one now, but vehicles are an option. Public transportation is a thing, and there is a portal system throughout the city. However, this portal system is not very reliable time-wise, because thousands upon thousands of people attempt to use it at once to save money.
Fair. God fucking damn it.
What did you do?
I see number 6 in the dark blue.
Number 6 in the dark blue? Oh, yeah. Don't worry, you can visit him at some point. For now, we are going to cut into the Lotus District of the city, to the campus of the Aetherian Academy, located in the southeastern part of the city, next, extremely close to the
Starfall Observatory?
Starfall Observatory. As they work in tandem many, many of a time. We will cut to one of the dorms of this vast campus. As I have asked everyone so far, Austin, would you like to describe the place we find your character in?
Sophie's living on campus and we're actively in his dorm. Calex himself is a very small, fat rabbit. So he kind of looks, he just takes up a chunk of his bed at any point in the time. If he has to share with someone, then it'd be, he'd be on like the left side wall. If he has the room to himself, whatever I say, just kind of expand it to that. But his part of the room, you would see dozens of astrological star maps, like charts, many different divination and time notes. It's almost as if he's mostly a visual learner, so he takes the time to put it out in a field around him. It's fairly organized. He's always been a person that likes to organize and reduce chaos around him. So while he does have things all over his walls and everything, you can see an almost chart of way. You can see it at when he started to where he is now. Everything is labeled. Even if there is quite a lot. Most likely, TB, if it's like early morning before classes type deal, he'd be sitting at either on the bed, working on some notes, or at a desk table if he has one. Probably trying to go over one of his previous lessons from the previous day. You find him, he has a habit of when he's thinking, he kind of just strokes at his beard hair, which he recognizes the younger kids here all make fun of him for it. Or not all of them, but it has been noted upon that he zones out doing that. And he doesn't mind. It's just whatever.
I feel personally attacked by this statement, but continue.
What?
What, you don't zone out stroking your beard sometimes?
I do. I have okay. A beard.
I do too. Even though I cut it all off, a bunch of it's already back.
But no, he's probably lost in thought reading some of his astrological charts.
Alright. Well, as you prepare to head off to your classes, what will be the first class on our friend's list here?
That I think I have to ask you, how long has he been at the academy? Because he's middle-aged now, but he would have joined the academy as soon as he was allowed to. So, would he have advanced from basic magic studies, or would he still be in basic magic studies?
Oh, he absolutely would have advanced past basic magic studies. And in certain fields, I'm sure he may even have reached the ability to start studying at the college for advanced things.
So, basing this on like a regular college transcript-ish, you only have to have so many classes as long as you're passing them.
Mm-hmm.
His biggest classes for magic are transmutation, divination, and then of course the gravity magics that he's found himself luckily enough to read into, which happen to be a kind of, I would say, an advanced version of both divination and or transmutation. So his three classes, at least for now, or at least for this day, would be transmutation, divination, and advanced magical studies in one or the other. First up on the bat would probably be... The last one is probably divination, because he takes on the star classes a lot, which you need to be able to see. So his first two classes would be transmutation and advanced magical studies. We'll go with transmutation for now.
All right. As you make your way across campus, as I said, this is like your typical college campus. This is, you know, it is a vast campus, but your magic. You have your ways to get around. There are free ways of transportation across the campus, as they already know they're bleeding your money dry. At least here. and you pass dozens upon dozens of students, hundreds of
many races, many origins, some from this plane and some not. You walk past, especially here, a solid at least third of the students here are of Fey origin, as this is Kyodi, the home of the Fey Rift. As you make your way towards your first class, you reach your classroom and you see your current professor, a taller elf male with dark black hair, a very short black beard, and extremely enunciated pointed ears, donned with an armor infused with many a type of arcane rune, and I will throw this man into visual aids. As you see standing before you, Professor Anatar Kordeth, the transmutation specialist at the Ethereum Academy.
Calex will just... good to see you, Professor. Am I late?
No, young one, you are about right on time. We have a few minutes if you would like to take a seat.
Wonderful, wonderful. I will get my notes out. And, Anatar probably is one of those people, that kind of likes to sit in the front row.
Calex.
Calex is one of those people that sits in the front row, trying, always want to be like the teacher. He's not necessarily a teacher's pet, but he's an avid researcher and wants to improve himself. So he sits in the front to get the best experience.
Okay. As you sit and prepare your notes for the lesson today, you watch as more and more students begin to file in. I wish I had found a good visual aid for this. These are relatively similar to a normal college lecture room, at least in a high-end university. So the rows of pews, basically, well, not exactly pews, but you get my meaning. Where at the bottom there is a large floor. This one a bit larger and adorned with, in the floor there are multiple runes and equipment for various magical usage and demonstration depending on the need of the professor. Along with in the center, a relatively large crystal. I would say about the size of the average human head, maybe a little taller, is embedded in the center of the floor in this lecture hall.
Is this crystal a Vizstone crystal or just like ruby?
It's not a Vizstone crystal. And looking at it, you see around the base of this crystal, there are many arcane runes around it, sending some sort of magic into this crystal.
Out of curiosity, is this a new addition to this room for like the lesson? Or is this something that has been here for a while we've had the chance to ask about?
This is something you would have seen exist before and maybe have an idea of, but you've never seen it in action. This is a fantasy projector.
Okay.
Essentially, it uses illusion magic to harness whatever it is the professor is trying to get across and provide physical demonstration that he cannot himself or he wants to look at in further detail.
Gotcha.
So as the class begins, Professor Anatar stands up to address the class. Good morning, ladies, gentlemen, and all other configurations of being. I presume you all understand the topic at hand here, but I will ask again, what is the School of Transmutation?
Calix's hand shoots up.
Yes, Calix.
Transmutation is the ability to take one material and alter its chemistry and makeup into a different one. This can be done such things as moving Earth and the like, and is a relatively simple process. Taking the base magics and applying them into a different version.
Correct. To put it in another way, transmutation itself specializes in transforming matter and energy to something of another sort. This could be, as you said, something like you're moving Earth, or something like polymorphing. Transmutation has many uses. The very common in battle is, as we mentioned, the polymorph spell. The movement of rock and earth is extremely useful in construction, and for residents of this city, our own police force uses a version of transmutation magic during their investigation to recreate the scenes to be physically investigated. Transmutation magic is very similar to illusion magic, but has its differences. Main one being, you can interact with it physically. As a simple question, someone tell me a benefit of being able to physically interact with the object when creating it?
Calix looks around to see if anybody else is going to participate in the lesson. While I'm looking around, I would like to ask, is there anybody else that is in the red robes of the, or an adept of the red robes?
Make a perception check.
All right.
Uh, 21. Looking around the room, you don't really see any other red robe members. None jump out to your eyes. Not in this classroom, at the very least.
I figured as much. I know that you have to, like, it's one thing to be an initiate, but an adept is a little bit higher. So, okay.
You'll see a younger Eladrin woman raise her hand. And, oh god, I need names. Always figure out the truth. Always. Ethan, this is why we'd be smart. Yes, Clara. And she puts her hand down. Well, with the use of something like transmutation and creating the physical object, you can find more detail and expound upon it. As we have seen with the success of our police force, it can aid in finding the smaller details that an illusion may not allow you to look at. Anatar goes, that is absolutely correct. And today we're just going to go over some of the ways transmutation can be used to fully recreate an object. And he will spend the rest of this lecture period showing you various items, something as simple as a gemstone, uncut to a weapon, and demonstrating how to essentially create these items out of pure transmutation energy.
Man, he's a very powerful sorcerer. Or wizard.
You'd be correct.
Very powerful mage.
And as the lecture comes to an end, he addresses the class one final time. Class, I challenge you to read more through your textbook into this, and if you feel safe enough, practice these simpler things, something of simply creating a stone or something of the like. As we get further into our time together in these advanced studies, we will do what we can to advance your ability to do so. But no homework for today. This is all I ask, is that you try. Dismissed. As everyone begins to close their books, their notepads, grab their things and make their way out of their room to their next class or wherever their path takes them next.
Calex is probably one of like the middle to last people. Just making sure he has everything with him, and he'll try and like take a look at the time. What does he need to go off to his next class, or does he have time to ask questions?
I would argue you have a solid 20 to 30 minutes in between classes, and like, these studies are all in the rough same area. It's not a far walk or anything like that. You would have a solid 20 to 30 minutes before you have to make your way to your next class.
He'll pause by Anatar's desk and, Professor, I do have a question.
Yes. What is it I can help you with?
In regards to the transformation studies that you've left us, I do admit that I'm rather not easy with the earth-based magics. Is there a different version I should be practicing on? Anything that, what would you recommend as the best version of transmutation magic?
I personally don't believe there is a best version of transmutation magic. If you're looking for something simple, if you have any sort of simpler spells that use transmutation that you can cast a solid chunk of times. Obviously, not all magic is infinite, but that could drastically help your development of at least the understanding of transmutation. Before you fully get into the pure manipulation of the energy itself.
Calex nods. Very good, very good. Thank you very much. I will see you tomorrow then.
Yes, sir. Don't be late.
A rabbit is never late. And with that, he'll go off towards his next class.
All right. So, what would be the next class on Calex's to-do list?
If divination is a late night one, so that was his early morning class. His mid class is probably the advanced magical studies, specifically for like the gravitational magics.
All right. So, very similar to your arrival at the for the transmutation one, except you get here a little earlier. You walk into the vast lecture hall used to utilize for the study of the advanced magical studies. However, this one is, the ceiling itself is quite a bit higher. You don't know why. You've never seen a reason yet for them to raise the ceiling of, or have a raised ceiling in any of the classrooms currently.
So this would be a new development?
For you, yes.
Ah, marvelous. Ah, I wonder how this will affect our teachings today.
And as you arrive to the classroom, you see an older human male
probably in his mid to late 50s. He has a blue cloak on, a longer white beard and long white hair. And he has a staff with a ruby adorning it, sitting at the desk next to him. I will post the image I have for this professor in visual aids. As you see, Professor Uthilian Dryernelf before you.
Uthilian Dryernelf. Calex will, hop into class and he'll kind of wave at the teacher before taking his seat. Good morning, Professor. Or afternoon, rather.
Good morning, Calex. Please take a seat. We hopefully will get started soon as the rest begin to arrive.
And he'll nod and, are we doing something special today? I've never seen the roof raises, such.
Today, I plan to just give a simple description, a simpler, I should say, description of what it is we shall be studying, as well as some demonstrations of what it can do.
Calix nods. And I would like to mention that when he does like a nod, it isn't like a one like sharp nod. It's a bouncing head several times nod. It's almost as if the flask that he seems to just take out at random moments during classes to drink from has given him a little too much energy.
The professor will... I'm not saying his name again. It's too long. Professor will watch you do this and go, I like the energy. I hope you are able to maintain it.
Calix nods again. Of course, Professor. I can do things. I am very good at learning.
Alrighty. Well, I'm going to retrieve a few items. I will be back in just a moment, and we will begin the class.
Calix will set up.
And he exits through a different doorway into more of a lab storage area of sorts. And he comes out with a few different rocks of various materials. You see some sort of metallic ore. You see just something simple that best way I could think I could compare it to is something like limestone, another gemstone, and he just, as well as a piece of coal, and he just sets them out on his desk.
Have the other students filed in yet, or is it still like,
as
setting up?
He would be gathering things, the students would have filed in.
Okay. Then Calix will not. I was going to say Calix would have risked a glance by pulling up the hatch, but he has enough people already. He doesn't need anybody else worrying about him, so he's just not going to do it while there's class going on.
Okay. As everyone finds their seats and prepares for the lesson, Professor Uthilian stands up and as... very similar to the teaching style of Anatar.
Good morning, pupils.
My name is Professor Uthilian Dryernelf, and I will be your guide through what the Academy likes to call the Advanced Magical Course, or as I like to think of it, the more
theoretical part of our line of expertise. So, I want to spend today introducing myself and showing some demonstrations of what the more theoretical sides of our magic can accomplish. Who here has heard of the term graviturgy?
Calix's hand kind of just shoots up. He's been playing around with gravity magic for a very long time.
Yeah. You and there are a handful of other students whose hands go up. Excellent. So, can someone give me a brief description of what it is graviturgy does?
For a technical thing, I'm not sure if I know the exact specifics, but Calix's hand remains up, but he's not exactly certain on this one. It's more of a theoretical guess.
I would say the other students' hands do slowly go down as he asks this question.
Calix will keep his hand up. He's a happy-go-lucky guy.
Yes, Calix, would you like to give it a shot?
To my general understanding, gravitational magic pushes force onto different objects, specifically space and time, and in doing so, warps the magic and reality around it to cause a differentiating effect. Yes?
Good. Extremely close. Graviturgy itself derives itself from the understanding and mastering of the forces that draw bodies of matter together or drive them apart. As you said, bending of things, that is correct. Gravity itself, the thing that graviturgy itself manipulates, is viewed as something as that warps the very fabric of space and time, or the space-time continuum, as those at the Starfall Observatory have come to call it. Let me demonstrate something. And you watch as the metallic ore, he floats it and begins pulling it up into the air. He pulls it up a solid, like, 60 feet, which is relatively close to how high the ceiling is. Not too far, too far off. And he simply drops it. It falls, hits the floor. Nothing special about it. That simple. I threw a rock. Unfortunately, not at anyone, but that's fun for later. Now, let me demonstrate something else with the same principle. And he'll raise the rock up again. But this time you watch him wave his hand and the rock shoots itself straight down into the ground and shatters the floor beneath it.
Calix's one eye currently just widens a little bit. This is a much more engrossing topic than his previous class.
The professor turns around and he pulls the ore back out of the ground, and the ore has slightly flattened itself. Not like full disc, but it is a lot more compact than it was before. As you can see, the manipulation of the gravity on an object can do many things. That was a simple spell known as fall. It simply accelerates the amount of force of gravity exerted onto an object to increase its speed many times over.
Calix's hand shoots up.
Yes, Calix.
In reference to your using fall, does this make levitate a transmutation-based spell, a gravitation spell?
it has its essences in Graviturgy and could be compared to one as such, but the transmuters have taken its name for themselves. Something like Levitate, though, or Fly, or the spell Featherfall, these work in tandem with the idea of Graviturgy. And something similar to what I just showed you, yes, it accelerates the force of gravity on an object, and he turns around, he grabs the gemstone. Or it can change the direction on an object. May I have a volunteer?
Calix's hand goes up.
I see you kept the energy. Please join me down on the lecture floor.
Calix will do a short, hop from off of his chair, and then just scurries over.
Right. He will hold the gem out in front of him, and as he lets go, the gem continues to float in the air. Would you do me a favor, sure, Calix, and please attempt to move the gem?
Do you mean physically move it or magically move it, sir?
Whichever way you prefer.
He's going to step to the side so that nobody's in the way of the rock. And then he's going to cast Gravity Well.
Okay.
So, as an object, I'm assuming it just auto fails.
Well, you throw this at the gemstone. The gemstone cracks, but it does not move.
Calix will look towards his professor. Was that right?
Yes, as right as it can be, thank you. As the class can see, your classmate here has used a fairly powerful spell that draws its essence from Graviturgy itself as well, but the object remains in place, albeit damaged. This is another gravitational spell used to suspend an object in a place to make it nigh immovable. Many enchanters found its use, and that is how we came to know of the object known as an immovable rod. And you watch as he drops the spell and the gem just shatters across the floor from where you cracked it.
What was the spell called?
He did not tell you the spell.
If Calix is still standing there, he'll... Sir?
Yes.
What spell was that allowed it to remain unmoved?
What's another... simple spell, not many take advantage of, and it has a name so obvious it's upsetting. That was a movable object.
He nods and goes, I see. May I return to my seat now?
Of course, please take your seat.
He will go back to his seat. Client climbs into it before going ahead.
You then watch him
He'll walk over to the piece of limestone and the piece of coal he still has sitting on the table. For my last trick, as I said, Graviturgy itself can change the direction of the movement of the bonds between things. It can expand them, and you watch as the limestone begins to break apart and just begin to float apart from one another. Or it could condense it. And you watch the chunk of coal he has just begins to condense on itself and start to glow a deep red color as he moves. He levitates it above his hand slightly as to not burn himself. And after about 30 seconds, he drops it back in his hand, and he's now holding a extremely rough shaped, but still it is a diamond.
I imagine a lot of students are impressed by this one.
Yes, there are multiple nods, and a couple students. I don't know how to describe the sound I'm thinking of, but I guess they grunt in approval is the best way I can think to describe that. And a couple of the students are in awe of the power demonstrated here.
Calex raises his hand.
Yes, Calex.
As you said, trick you did with the coal there to turn it into a diamond. If that is so, well, maybe not easily done. You're a powerful practitioner, but why is it not done more frequently to aid in jewelry and material components for other spells?
That is an excellent question. This is where transmutation outshines Graviturgy, as yes, I can do this and turn a piece of carbon into a diamond or a other gemstone. However, it is less reliable on the size of the product and the shape, whereas a true transmutation specialist can create the object with the shape. There are many more uses for something like what I just demonstrated. The safest way was this.
Nods. Writes down in his notes.
He begins to address the class again, but as he addresses the class, you watch him wave his hand as the gems and while he's talking, the gemstone will reassemble itself, and the crack in the floor will begin to shift back into the normal stone floor that was smooth as it originally was.
I apologize for the simpler or the shorter class today, but I thought it more important to demonstrate the first branch of the theoretical we will be going into before we start the practice and true study of said subject. But I would very much recommend you continue reading or practicing any magic that seems to draw on this power for the next class. And I will see you all in the morning. And just quick side note, there will be no office hours tonight as I have a meeting.
Calex looks sad at this as he was going to stay behind to talk to him.
I mean, you can stay behind to talk to him. He means his office hours.
Okay. Calex will wait as other people file out then. upon there being significantly less portion, almost to no people left, he'll approach the desk and, Professor?
Yes, energetic one.
That last bit of magic you did, where you reverted the changes done, the fixing of the gemstone and the floor, was that transmutation or some other sort of magic?
Did you say to reverse the damage and everything?
Yeah, bring the floor back together and the shard back together.
It was a form of transmutation. At least to assemble everything, as I did not wish to destroy a lecture room or a very, very nice crystal that I probably should not have used for the demonstration, out of fear of breaking it.
You said a form of transmutation? Does this mean that it is something, like you said, the advanced theory of, that we would be participating in later in the year?
It is similar, but what I used was not the same as what we will go over later in the year.
He seems a little saddened by the fact, but not... of course, Professor. Out of curiosity, would it be on, like, next year's roster? An even further version of Advanced Magics?
Oh, we will go over that more parts of the theoretical part of magic as we get later in the semester. Gravaturgy is one of the simpler ones to grasp. That is why I start with the demonstration of it first.
He nods. Thank you, Professor. If you do need any help at all, this topic very much does interest me, but I do regret that I have to leave now. So if you ever need help, just let me know.
All right, then. Knowing this, I have high expectations of what I shall receive during class and this semester from you.
Of course, sir. Of course.
All right, I will see you in the morning.
Have a pleasant night.
And, Calex leave.
As you leave his desk, can you do me a favor and roll me a perception check?
I'm wondering if I should take the pass or not.
You can't... I will let you take a passive in this, because this is... Because passive is more for, like, passively viewing something, and but you could argue this is, because you're leaving.
Yeah, I'll take the passive. It's a 15.
15?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, as you leave the desk, you watch him begin to cast more spells on the limestone and the diamond, and reassembles the limestone, and with a 15, you're not too sure what he's doing to the diamond. It's very strange and not any sort of magic you would recognize.
Is it just heating back up or cooling, or just, it's just an odd thing that I know?
None of the above. It is just beginning to change.
Calex makes a note to ask him about it later, but his professor said that he had business to attend to later, so he's got classes.
All right.
Approximately, so what time of day is this?
By now, I would say it is probably around 2-3 p.m.
Okay. His divination class probably isn't very until late, because he does it off the astrological charts.
Well, so here's the thing. The divination class, the next one, starts in... Involving stars charts starts in about an hour.
Ah.
that's the case, he'll probably take, like, you know, the next 30 or so minutes to go get something to eat before attending class. Right.
You find, as you go to find food, you find various vendors and restaurants throughout the campus that they have here for the students, and various types of food, from noodles, though not as good as the noodle shop that recently left the city about a year ago, but it's still some good food.
He's a fat rabbit. He's been around for a while. If that noodle shop closed, the better one closed, I'm sure he's found something else, and it's like his daily go-to. He'll probably head there, wherever you want to put him. Right. Something that does a vegetable base.
Yep. You go up to the stand, you order some more vegetable-based noodle soup, and within about 10 minutes, they, if not less, they float out your soup along with the dozens of other students that are currently ordering their food. And sitting where you're eating, this is a larger expanded area of the campus that has the tables off to the sides by where the actual vendors and all are. And there is a large walkway that expands outward where you see many students practicing magic in their downtown.
Calex will take a spot, one of the benches closer to the practice field, and he'll eat while observing. Not trying to like be creepy or anything, but he's just making notes of how people are using magics in different situations. Seeing someone use the earth magic to trip their opponent or whatnot. He's making note of how things could be used differently.
Yeah. As you're sitting there, when you go to sit down, you notice at your feet there is a line of runes that extend from a little, about a foot away from where the table would be towards what you're watching, and it extends in a line all the way down the walkway.
Do I recognize the language of the runes? I know Common, Sylvan, Fajab, and Dwarvish.
You do not.
Taking just a moment, the runes, are they new, or is this something that he's seen before?
These are runes that have been there for a while, but you have never actually seen them activate.
Setting his soup on the table after taking a bite really quick, he'll glance around before he's going to cast Where Am I Going? And now I know it doesn't decode secret message or anything, but I would at least understand the physical words that it's attempting to make out.
So, you cast Comprehend Languages and look down at the arcane runes on the ground in front of you. They don't necessarily spell anything out, but looking at them and getting more of a sense of what they are, these appear to be some sort of abjuration set of runes. Similar to something you see put on, like, a magical shield.
Okay, so protection-based runes is what he's gathering.
Yes.
He'll nod. Content in what he's learned. He might not have known the exact thing, but he also knew he wasn't going to get the exact wording because he didn't put it down. So to have figured out that it's protection-based runes, he feels a little happier that he learned something today. And he'll sit down to finish his meal while watching.
You sit back and you watch the students. You see some simply practicing magic, but there are a good bit of students who are dueling each other. Which is why they have many a more divination-based caster stationed around here, so students can practice their fighting, but the college won't lose any of their students, hopefully, in doing so. But, as I was saying, you see the students practicing their normal spells, simply the casting, the use, things like that, as well as those practicing their use in combat. You're watching the duels, and you see them simply throwing relatively simple spells back at each other. No one's, exactly chunking fireballs around in this area. But you watch one of the fights, and you watch as one of the casters, male gnome, he holds out his hand as I need to get the exact number here. Give me just a moment. And you watch three magical darts shoot out and fly towards his opponent. And the opponent has a brooch on his chest that glows and the spell does nothing. And
Austin, I think, knows what that is, but...
Yeah.
Oof. I'm too absorbed in soup.
You are very absorbed in your soup. You are absorbing your soup. but you see the gnome, throw his hands up in the air and he yells, "That's not fair. I thought we weren't allowed to use magic items." To which the other person, who you now notice as a female Goliath, turns and goes, "I wasn't told anything, I apologize." And the gnome, walks up, and the gnome starts trying to physically engage the Goliath in a fight, as the Goliath, doesn't engage him back, and just tries to blow him off, before eventually shoving to the side and walking in your general direction. As you're watching, though, you watch as the gnome reaches out his hand and electricity begins to spark from his hand and he shoots out a lightning bolt at her. Go ahead.
That's touch. Hold on. I guess I just do message and duck.
As you send her this message, she turns around and sidesteps out of the way of the lightning bolt as it flies directly towards you.
Oh, bother.
As it begins to approach you, you watch the runes in front of you light up one by one, extending down the walkway. And as the lightning bolt gets to about a foot in front of you, it impacts an invisible wall these runes have put up, and it scatters across the wall in front of you, creating patterns of lightning as the power this gnome threw is rendered useless against it. You watch multiple of the students sitting at the benches near you kind of laugh and clap as they see this happen. And as the lightning eventually leaves, the caretakers around rush up to the Goliath woman to make sure she is okay. And one of the teachers around the campus takes the gnome, and they walk away as he is scolding the gnome and heading in the general direction of what you know to be the headmistress's office. Not here.
Calix will blink a few times before just slowly grabbing back his spoon and just eating.
Eventually, the bustle dies down and the caretakers disperse from the sides of the woman, and she continues along her day and gets in line to get herself some food. Now, what is it you would like to do as you finish your delicious food, your delicious noodles?
This female Goliath, you said, right?
Mm-hmm.
Do I know her as one of our teachers?
No. This is seemingly just another student.
Okay. I knew there was a female Goliath teacher, so.
Mm-hmm.
He'll finish up his food, return the bowl or whatever it is that you have to do. And with only like another 30 or so minutes to get to class, he'll begin his trek there.
All right. So, as you begin your trek to where you are taking the lecture, we pass by the lecture halls around where you were earlier, and we continue on through the campus towards the Starfall Observatory, which I actually never found an image for. But the Starfall Observatory itself is a massive very similar to in what your normal observatory would be nowadays. The building itself is very round with a domed top and a panel that slides open, which you would have seen it slide open before in times as the end of the telescope would exit it. As you make your way into the building, you see what to Calex would be a familiar sight, but to everyone else would be new. The inside of the Starfall Observatory. There is an outer layer of, you know, offices and receiving equipment and things like that for some of the more advanced missions they might carry out. But as you step through that layer, you enter the actual lecture hall of the Starfall Observatory, centered around the telescope.
I have a point of clarification I'd like to ask.
Mm-hmm.
Is this like the start of a new quote-unquote school year? Because like the last few teachers, they've introduced themselves to the class, and
this would be the start of a new semester.
Okay. That's what I was wondering.
Not a whole new school year. This would be the start of the spring semester.
Okay.
Roughly.
Okay.
Would you like the exact date? Because I can give that to you as well.
I do not need the exact date at the moment. I just was curious because they were, you know, introducing themselves. And if they were in the middle of season, Calix would have already known them.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That's my point of clarification. Thank you.
All right. But you enter the room, and this observatory is massive. There is a very large distance between the seats and the actual body of the telescope. And the stairway up to it. And you walk in and you see hundreds of students in this lecture hall. This is a massive and very popular part of what the Aetherian Academy offers. And in the center of the room at the telescope, you see a handful of people making adjustments to it in preparation for whatever they choose to use it next. And at the center, you recognize the professor of this part of this school of magic. You see a shorter female dwarf with brown hair in braids, a green and brown dress, and arcane tattoos around her eyes and on her top of her forearms. And I will post her image in visual aids. However, you can't hear what they're saying because, as I said, there is a massive distance between the two of you. Or, well, you and the group of them. And this lecture hall is... this building is full of chattering students getting ready for a presentation.
That's okay. My teacher has things to do of their own, and as much as I would like to know what they're saying, Alex, at this point, is probably, he's trying not to interfere with his teachers. He knows he can be a little much sometimes in this.
Okay.
Not to mention that he's in his literal favorite place in the academy, and is probably distracted.
Alright. You take a seat amongst the students, and as you sit down, you begin to notice on the desks at these, in this lecture hall, you see what is essentially a smaller version of the crystal you saw in the center of the lecture halls.
Ah, so...
a much, much smaller version.
Projection fields.
Yes. And you see one at each of the desks. Or the seats, I should say. The lecture seats. After about 15 minutes or so, you see the group that was around the professor begin to leave as she walks up to what seems to be some sort of command console and presses a button, and all of the crystals at all the desks light up as an image of her is displayed directly in front of you, as she projects a live feedback directly to y'all, because of how vast this hall is and how many students she is addressing in order to properly convey whatever she wishes to.
That is so cool, and I wish regular college did that.
You see, watch her straighten up as she, good morning, class. Today I wanted to do a slight walkthrough of what it is we look at here at the observatory and how that itself pertains to this magic. As you can see, you each have your own small display of me so that I can speak to you and keep you a safe distance back from the mechanisms here. So, to introduce you to what you are looking at for those unfamiliar, this is the Starfall Observatory, and this is the main piece of the observatory. This was designed by a many divination and evocation specialists in order to peer beyond what we see with the naked eye and understand its composition and its draw. I'm sure some of you are confused why we are using something such as this in the middle of broad daylight. And that is because we have enchanted scopes such as this to ignore, in the simplest terms, not only the lights of the sky, but the ever brilliant lights of the city around us so that we may properly view the sky. She'll spend the next 30-45 minutes droning on about the mechanics of the actual mechanism of the telescope, the idea of the focus and the radial diameter and what an arc second is and what the ways the magnification of the telescope works.
Listen, this is probably like the at least third or fourth time he's heard this before, and he's still avidly paying attention. Like, this is his favorite class.
Yeah. And just on this, she goes on for about a solid 30 minutes before she eventually begins to trail off and continue on. And after another, like, 15 minutes, she catches herself. Apologies, I got lost in the craftsmanship. The last mechanism of the telescope I wish to display to you is how it moves. Many of you are probably wondering why we keep you so far away, which is what I will demonstrate now. And she moves her hand over some more controls at the pedestal, and the entire room in front of you begins to twist itself as it aims the point, the direction the telescope and the dome above it is facing. And as she does that, the walls around you begin to shift as well as the building moves with it. And you can hear the whir of the mechanisms and the largest conglomeration of them appear to come from closer to the telescope in that distance they keep you away from it. Additionally, the telescope itself has the ability to link to the crystals in front of you to display whatever it's looking at. So, as I will demonstrate something simple, and you watch her rotate the telescope and aim it, and she hits a button, and displayed on everyone's screen is an upside down image of the Imperial Palace, as she has lowered the magnification and aimed it to something everyone would recognize. Now, I know I am boring you with the talk of equipment, but we are going to spend more time talking about the types of equipment we use to measure the output we receive here. And she begins to again drone on about things such as simple as prisms to absorption spectrums and the barometers used to measure the composition of the light they are looking at by comparing it to the absorption of the known elements to what light they are receiving through the prism. After she finishes that explanation, she turns back around to face away from the telescope and face the class herself again. I now wish to raise the option of anyone has any questions for me. And as she says this, you hear a little whir as a button flips out on the side of the desk near the crystal on every single desk.
Does anybody else have questions for her?
So far, none of them are going off, and you look around to see a lot of students kind of viewing their notes. There's quite a handful that have dozed off during the mechanical talk. No one has jumped the gun to answer a question yet, or ask a question yet.
Calix presses the button.
As you... Yeah?
No, you're fine.
No. As you press the button, you watch as the crystal begins to pulse a deep red color, and a light up at her control center glows. And she pushes the button, and you could very faintly make out as a small... She has her own small projection pop up in front of her. Yes. What is your question, sir?
I do apologize. I'm sure she recognizes Calex because he's been in her class many times.
Mm-hmm.
For those of us new here, why do you study divination? Why would you choose it over the other schools?
Interesting question. A lot of divination itself has to deal with the preservation of life. Obviously, every branch of magic has more than that, a single focus. But I like divination because it helps to physically heal those around me.
Hey, a follow-up question, if you don't mind.
Yes.
Divination allows us to predict future events, and of course, we can kind of use it to delve into memories and the like to figure out previous events. Could divination be used in conjunction with transmutation or the like to affect time and allow us to change things from the past or in our futures?
A very interesting question. Divination itself does not work to manipulate anything like that. It can be used in conjunction with other theoretical to manipulate things, but no one has yet discovered any sort of way to manipulate events of time that is at least publicly known or known to the Academy.
Thank you. That is my questions for the moment.
Thank you. I did want to expand on the first question our friend here asked on why divination can be chosen over other schools of magic. I would also, though, like to add on, I am not going to sit here and make a statement in front of you telling you your school of magic is awful and you need to choose divination. I would like to tell you the idea of why I enjoy it. As our friend mentioned, you can peer into things such as predictions of what is to come and memories. Additionally, there are spells divination has to see a far distance away, a more magical means of doing something similar to what a telescope does on distant objects. Additionally, divination is used to weed out the other magics around it, such as detecting what is around or discovering the properties of something magical. Any other questions? And you look around and no one's making a move. Everyone just seems to be waiting for day one to end so they can get into the interesting stuff the next day.
He seems slightly saddened by the fact that there's not as many scholars like him in the class, but that's okay. They're at least here and trying.
Well, if that is all, we will go ahead and end the lecture here, and I will see everyone tomorrow evening. And she dismisses the class, and
a bunch of students go to get up, and you watch as many students have to turn to others next to them to wake them up as they dozed off during the talk of the mechanics of everything.
Is the light on our... Is, like, the transmission feed still available?
Not anymore. It has been turned off.
Okay. Then I'll ask this as a previous thing. Having been to observatory before, is the general public just allowed to use it, or do you have to make requisitions?
You cannot use the telescope yourself. You are allowed to view things, come in and view things that they themselves are observing occasionally, but you yourself are not able to take control of the telescopes.
Can you put in a requisition to like secure yourself some own time to use it?
To use it? No. Can you request them to observe something? Yes.
Similar enough in thing. That's fine. Okay.
All right. So what is it you do now?
Well, that's his classes for the day, at least those three. I guess he, no one assigned any homework outside of just study. So, I guess just explore campus for a little bit, and he's got some time for once before the actual classes and homework has to happen. So just enjoy the day or what's rest of it. I guess he would, he'd go check in at the, dueling field, see if anything new, special is going on. Also, I had a question. What is this building?
Which building? That is the, that is part of the Starfall Observatory.
Okay.
Like, this isn't exactly what the campus looks like, because, you know, I can't exactly find Cyberpunk Fantasy Campus.
You're fine.
But that would be part of, that would be one of the smaller parts of the observatory. You go to explore the campus a little bit, go by the dueling fields again, and there's nothing too special currently going on. There's not a ton of students out as it is getting later into the evening, and the school does not want students dueling during the night when less of the staff are available to help them.
Are there stores on campus?
Depends on what you're looking for.
No, I'm basically just browsing the magical stores if they've got it.
There are no magical stores.
I was gonna assume that with like the magical item and enchantment class that students would be testing and might be even encouraged to try and sell their own goods. So I was wondering about that.
There are no magical item shops on campus. And the magical item enchantment class / enchantment magic class, they do walk through enchanting magic items, but they enchant extremely simple magic items in the class, and they try to focus on more of enchanting something they would get their own use out of. And most students would go out to the Moonlight Bazaar if they no longer wish to keep the items they had. Also, I think the music stopped, so let me...
I mean, if that's all there is for the day, after exploring around a little bit longer, you'd probably go home, tuck in, or dorm.
As you explore around the campus, you do end up running into Professor Cordeth Anatar, the transmutation specialist.
Mm-hmm.
and you see him talking to a group of students who are all bouncing around excited, and they each have flyers and golden tickets in their hands, and they're handing them out, and they are explaining it to the professor. And you walk over. As you approach, you hear one of the other people standing in front of him, going, "So they're putting on a festival in the Twilight Plaza, and the Luna Theater will be putting on a show, and they gave the campus tickets to give to the students for free as a gift to them for working so hard, as well as the staff, in a hope that they can come and enjoy a little bit of fun."
Okay.
Thank you. As Anatar sits there and listens to this, he asks the students, "Would you be willing to give me two so I can run one to my father? He did not wish to stay out late this evening." To which one of the students goes, "Absolutely, here you go. Please, Professor Cordeth, tell Professor Cordeth that we hope he feels better in the morning."
Calix is like, tilts his head at that, and like, the professor's not feeling well?
Do you say that out loud?
I guess he's like near some of the students. He might not have said it to like all of them, but he'd probably have said it to one of the ones that was nearby.
Oh.
Is the professor not feeling well?
Anatar notices you and goes, Calix. Yes, he should be fine. He's just very, very tired. He's old, even for an elf. So he needs his rest. However, I do wish to run this to him and hope that he will be up to accompanying this. We haven't gone to plays in a long time. Hopefully he will enjoy it as we used to with my brother.
I wish you your best, and that he gets or feels better. Maybe I'll see you there, as he looks towards the students with the tickets.
The student will turn to you. "Would you like one there? I don't know if you overheard, but they're giving them out for free to the students."
That's very interesting. Yes, please. It will be a nice thing to do.
Right. They hand you this small golden ticket, and as I've had to say in every Session Zero, no, this is not Willy Wonka. But they hand you a small
chocolate factory or not.
I did specify exactly what it was actually in both other Session Zeros because they read it. You have a ticket to a theater play being put on by the Lunar Theater. Next, it is Next Divinitas, which is the 28th of Tempest, is the date on the ticket.
And what's today's date?
Today would be the 24th of Tempest.
So in 4 days?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. He'll make a note to go to a play in 4 days if he reads the details right.
You make your way back to the dorm that you currently call home. And how does Calex get himself ready for the end of his day?
He takes a shower, or bath, whatever is equivalent. Use prestidigitation on like the covers and his clothes and the like. Gets ready for gets ready to set it up for the next day. And then as it's closer to evening now, and he can actively see out to the stars and the like, he'll note down the star's progress as an astrological chart to add to his already long list of them. What he seems to do is every time he makes a new one for the new day, even if they're like not very different, because you know, day to day stars don't change very much, he marks down the position, and then he'll put the new one up on the wall and take the oldest one. They'll usually probably have about 4 or 5 at a time. He'll take the oldest one and put it into a notebook, or a binder rather, that has a list for the past several years. And you can gather that he takes these and he'll put them on his bookshelf, which has multiple different binders from over all the years he's been studying the stars.
Can't wait for this character to find out about the exile.
I know, right?
Why?
But as you notate the progress of the celestial bodies in the sky, make me and I will give you a choice of, you can do a straight intelligence check, a nature check, or a survival check.
What, all no? Of those are zeros.
Ah, beautiful.
Sure, we'll go a nature check. Yeah, no. None of those are things I'm good at. I'm good with Arcana and history.
You know, roll it one more time for me, just because this has to deal with something you've been doing. This astrological stuff. Okay, that was no good.
But not good with this.
You're looking over the progression of the star charts. And the progress of the other celestial bodies you marked down. And you go through your notebook and you see the pattern year by year, it, you know, barely changes. There may be slight day shifts where the charts of spring might happen a day or two, begin a day or two earlier than the year before. But you're looking at the pattern of everything, and you look at the charts you've taken over the past rough week. And there's a pattern that feels familiar to you, but also it's a pattern that you don't align with this part of the year, with the path of the celestial bodies.
It's feeling off, but like I've seen it before.
You've seen this pattern before, but it's not something that would trying to think. It's not a pattern that normally would arrive just randomly. Normally there's a progression to things you can notice, but you're looking at your notes and just something with the pattern or everything just feels like it took a change randomly, but nothing drastic. The progress of the celestial bodies just seem to have slightly shifted.
Calix will kind of like rub out his eyes and go, I think the sleep must be getting to me. This I could have sworn I'd seen this, but it should not be happening this way. Maybe I'll try it again later. Rest. Rest is good. I will do that, and then he'll pause to look at the notes and just... No. I'll look again later. It is too much for my brain now.
Alright. as you lay down to rest and consciousness escapes from you as you fall to sleep, preparing for your next days, I'm going to go ahead and call session here. As you prepare for the days to come.